He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion.
Good morning, New Hope Church. We're so excited to be here with you this morning. If you would, please stand to your feet as we enter into worship. Jesus, we love you. Father, we adore you with all that we have. Holy Spirit, we say come this morning and have your way. Come and do whatever you want to, Father. We give our full attention and our full heart to you. God, we bless you. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise, for you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, sing it out. And if our God, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And what could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Just the voices this morning. 'Cause our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God, we believe it, that our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, lift up a shout of praise this morning.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took my breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. So the overwhelming, never-ending, endless love of God always chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. deserve, still you give yourself away. I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. I took a breath, you breathe your life. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. You won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, he chases me down, fights till
washing in, flooding over us. Wave after wave, wave after wave of your love crashing over us. Oh, we will sink or swim, but no matter what, we're diving in to your ocean of love this morning. It's wave after wave, wave after wave of your love covers us. We stand in all amaze of your love, Jesus. So would you come, wave after wave, wave after wave of your love. It's the only reason why we're here, to encounter your goodness. It's the only reason why we're here, to encounter your You give a life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, give a life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, it's your breath.
Every voice lifted up.
'Cause all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will say, these bones will sing, great So great you are, so great you are, so great you are. It's your breath filling up our lungs again and again and again and again and again and again and again. How can we not come alive when it's your breath inside of us, Jesus? How could we be afraid when you are for us? When you are for us, Jesus, God, we breathe you in. We breathe you in. Deeper and deeper and deeper, we let your breath fill our lungs. Yes. 'Cause we were meant to be face to face, and heart to heart, and hand in hand.
Hallelujah. 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 The Apostle Paul went to the town of Ephesus. It was a place known for magical arts, spells, incantations. It was also famous for the Temple of Diana, one of the Greek gods, an idol, an image, a beautiful temple built to honor a cold dead statue. There was a disturbance in the town, and the people gathered in the auditorium, and for 2 hours straight they yelled out, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians." For 2 hours. "Great is Diana of the Ephesians, a cold, dead stone statue." And the people yelled out, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians." And here we are, the people of God, who serve the living God, the creator God, the redeemer God, the healer God, the provider God, the provision God. Great is Jesus Christ. Great is Jesus Christ. Great is Jesus Christ. Great is Jesus Christ. Great is Jesus the Lord. Great is our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Great is our Lord. 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 Great are you, Jesus. Great are you, Jesus. Great are you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 He's redeemed us. He's saved us. He's called us out. He's sanctified us, set us apart for His glorious purposes. He's filled us with His life. He's put resurrection in us. He's given us purpose and meaning in life. There is none like You, Jesus. There's none like You, Lord. You are great, oh God, awesome, powerful, wonderful. There is none like You, Lord. Glorify Thy name. Glorify Thy name. Bring glory to Your name today, Jesus. Bring glory to Your name today, Jesus. Keep your hearts open.
A fiery furnace of affliction has come upon many during this past season to stretch and to temper you for such a time as this. I would acknowledge that a great victory was won in the highest court of your land, and my children have rejoiced, and rightly so. But the powers of darkness have raged with greater fervor. And I will tell you that in the coming elections, after the result, there will be a new wave of vengeance and rage that will come upon because of the powers of darkness realize how much they have lost. And I will tell you that in your governmental structures, it is as though great oaks with deep roots have grown, infiltrated that which was meant for good. And the roots are deep and the roots are strong. And there will come a pulling out of those trees of unrighteousness and demonic purposes. But with it, my children, I will tell you that there will be great shaking. There will be chaos. And there will be anarchy breaking out here and there. But I urge you most strongly to hold steady. To not let it be all about you, but about the kingdom of God and about cleansing and purity, as so many of you have interceded for. It will be like a great complicated surgery that has taken place in a body weakened and on the verge of death. And there is a time of recovery after that surgery, but it was successful. So understand the times, understand the seasons. Be ready in your hearts and your minds and your spirits. Pay attention to what's going on. But fear not, for that which you have prayed for is coming. But there will be flack temporarily while things are made right.
Let's set our eyes on the eternal and not the temporal. Let our hearts know that regardless of what happens in the days and weeks and months ahead, that Jesus Christ is the sovereign Lord of all. He sits on the throne of the universe, and He is in control. Even when everything seems to be spinning out of control, He is the sovereign Lord of all. And He's always in control. Keep your faith and trust in Him. This morning, we're going to receive the Lord's Supper. It's a time when we, the family of God, remember Christ's death. We proclaim His death. We declare to the heavens, we declare to the world around us that Jesus Christ died and then rose again from the dead. But through His death, He brought us near to Him. Through His death, He paved a way for us to receive forgiveness of our sins, cleansing of all of our unrighteousness, healing in our bodies, our minds, our spirit, our soul. And as we partake of the elements of communion, we are partaking of Jesus. We are partaking of Him. His body broken so that we could be made whole. His blood shed so that we could be in covenant relationship with a living God. But the scripture gives a warning. When you partake, do so in a manner that is worthy. As a matter of fact, if you don't, you could die. The Bible says that. It's a reason why many of you are sick and some have died, because they didn't approach this in a worthy manner. And that worthy manner is faith. Faith. Faith in Jesus Christ. Faith in what he did. That you are secure and you find your security in Jesus and him alone. Today, if you've joined us and you're new to our church family, maybe this is your first visit with us. We want you to know that you are welcome to partake. You do not have to be a member of this church. You simply need to be a member of the body of Christ. You need to have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. The Bible tells us clearly that we've all fallen short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, not one of us. And the wage of our sin is death, to be eternally separated from God. But the gift of God is eternal life, in that even while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And if you would put your faith in who he is and what he did, and then call on the name of the Lord, turning away from sin and turning to him, he will forgive you, he will cleanse you, and he will adopt you into his family. And now, no longer alienated or an enemy, you are a son or a daughter of the living God, and he gives you his name. He gives you his name. The ushers are going to serve the elements of communion in just a moment. And I want you to hold them, and we're going to partake of them together as a family. But if you don't know or have assurance in your heart that everything is right between you and Jesus, then in this moment, reach out to him. Call on his name. Lord, I need you. Be my Savior. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. A simple prayer of faith will seal the deal, and you're welcome to partake of the Lord's Supper. Let's continue to worship as we pass out the elements of communion.
What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Cause death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you
a thankful Jesus for the price you paid for me, for me, for me. You would have done it all just for me. We're thankful, Father.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, as we hold the bread in our hand, we are reminded of your body and the price that you paid. You bore the weight of all of our sin. You took upon yourself the wrath of God directed towards sin. We deserved the punishment, but you took it upon yourself. Your great love for us was beyond measure. You pursued us, Lord, until we yielded and surrendered. And today, as your sons and daughters, as we stand in this holy place, we lift up the bread and we are reminded of the love of God, which passes all understanding. It's a forever love, an unconditional love, a love that would lay down and sacrifice and die so that we could live. We partake of you now. We partake of your love. Thank you, God. Even as we eat of the bread, let healing flood our bodies, souls, and spirits and minds. We thank you for your greatness and goodness to us. In Christ's name, let's break and partake. Thank you, Jesus. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes." There it is, Lord, the promise of your return. And that one day we'll drink this cup with you in your presence. Until that day, we hold this cup of covenant and we are reminded of your faithfulness, that you honor your word above your own name, and every promise is yes and amen to them who believe. We partake of you. Thank you for your faithfulness. Come quickly, Lord, so we could drink this cup with you in your presence. Amen.
Because Jesus, you're the lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon a rock, and now I know that I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. And my Savior, my closest friend, and I will worship you until the very end. 'Cause Jesus, you're the lover of my soul. And Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon a rock, and now I know that I love you.
Praise him this morning. Praise Him. Lord, we worship You. We glorify You. We praise You, Jesus. Glory to Your name, Lord. Glory to Your name, Lord. Jesus, You are worthy of our praise. You're worthy of glory and honor. You're worthy of our love and affection this morning, Jesus. Praise You, Lord. Praise You, Jesus. Glory to Your name. Glory to Your name. Just have to share this. Just driving in this morning, I was listening to the Joy FM, and this song came on. It's called Greater Things, and God's greatness is just the theme this morning. Amen. And it says, I will not fear, for You are with me. I've seen this fight from the victory. And that's just been ringing in my spirit this morning. And just even as we took communion this morning, that we're seeing this fight from the victory. That's why Jesus says, as often as you do this in remembrance of Me. Because He wants us to be reminded that He sees this from the point of victory, and that we need to see this from the point of victory as well. Amen? Matter of fact, in that same setting, when He was with the disciples and He shared what was about to happen, He says, listen, I tell you these things so that in Me you'll have peace. He says, in this world you're going to have many troubles, but fear not, for I have overcome the world. Fear not. Amen? And we don't have to be afraid this morning, because our God is great. Our God is mighty. We don't have to be afraid this morning, whatever we face, whether it be sickness or hardship or conflict. We don't have to be afraid, because we can look at it from the point of victory. In this world, we are going to have troubles, but we don't have to fear, because He's overcome the world. Amen? Why don't we all stand together and grab hold of the hand of the person on our left and right? One family who's facing some trouble this morning is the Bowman family. If you didn't get word, just yesterday morning, Bob went home to be with the Lord and to join Sandy in heaven. Amen? It was 3 weeks ago yesterday that Sandy passed. And now Bob's with her and with Jesus in heaven. Amen? But we know, as great as the rejoicing in heaven is, that there's sorrow here on this side of the veil. Amen? So we want to lift up the Bowman family and the extended family there. And we'll keep you posted as to when the memorial service is going to be in the next couple weeks. And just let's keep them in prayer this morning. Amen? And there's so many that are here in our midst, they're part of our church family, that are facing trouble, that need sickness healed. Amen? That need provision. They need a job. They need just whatever it is. They need direction. So if you're here this morning and you need a touch from the Lord, you need an answer, whatever it could be, just go ahead and squeeze that person's hand you're holding and let them know, will you pray for me? Will you join with me in this? Amen? So let's go before the Lord with confidence that He hears us and that He's got this taken care of. Amen? So, Heavenly Father, we come before You this morning. Lord, we approach Your throne of grace with confidence. Lord, we belong. We are Your sons and Your daughters. And Lord, not only are we Your sons and Your daughters, but Lord, Your word tells us that You hear the cries of Your people. So Lord, as this morning, as we come before You, we ask, Lord God, Lord, that whatever the need may be with the person on our left and our right, Lord, that You would meet that need. Lord, if it's provision, Lord, if it's relationship healing, Lord, if it's restoration of a separated loved one, Lord God, if it's healing, God, whatever it might be, Lord, would You meet their need this morning? Lord, would You give them that encouragement this morning? Would You come to that place of their need this morning and take care of it? And Lord, we lift up the Bowman family to You today, God. God, we thank You, God, that Bob and Sandy are rejoicing in Your presence this morning. Lord, that it's a whole other kind of worship service for them. But Lord, we pray for the family that are left here behind, Lord. Those that are in sorrow, those that are in grieving, Lord. Lord, give them hope. Lord, let it be like Your word says, that we don't mourn like those who have no hope. Lord, give them hope. Give them hope, Lord God. Give them strength, Lord. Fill their hearts with joy, Lord Jesus. Now, Lord, You bless us this day, Lord. Lord, we release blessing into that person's hand we're holding, Lord. Lord, we release joy, Lord. We release provision, God. We release just satisfaction, Lord God. Right now, we ask, God, that You would move in this place today, Lord God. Bless Your word here in the sanctuary. Bless Your word in the classrooms with the kids, Lord God. Let it go forth with might and power, and let signs and wonders follow the preaching of the word. God, we give You glory and honor and praise. It's in Your precious name, Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen and amen. Amen. Now let's continue our worship as we greet one another this morning. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. It's good to be in God's house this morning, right? And good to be among God's people. Praise the Lord. We want to welcome you to New Hope Church. If this is your first time with us this morning, why don't you put your hand in the air? It's good to have you this morning. Anybody else first time? Let's welcome our first time guest this morning. Amen. Did they give you a coffee mug when you came through the door? Okay, great. Awesome. There's a card in that mug. We just ask you to fill that out and drop that in the offering when it comes by, and it just helps us to get to know you a little bit better. And Pastor will give you a call this week, and thank you for being with us. Amen. Praise God. There is a lot happening here at New Hope right now. Hopefully, you got one of the bulletins coming through the door. If you didn't, make sure you grab one on the way out. Also, as you know, last weekend was our missions conference, our Global Impact Weekend. If you did not get one of these last week or coming through the door this morning, we go ahead and lift your hand up and the ushers will get one to you. We want to make sure you know what's going on when it comes to missions and our missionaries and what God's doing through New Hope in the world. Amen? Now, once a month we have what's called a newcomers reception. So if you've never been over to that to join us, it's going to be immediately after service in the cafe area over here. And if you are new to New Hope in the last month, or like I said, you haven't come over to one of those meetings, I want to encourage you to come over. Pastor and I will be over there, and we'll some of our elders, and we'll get to answer any questions that you might have and just kind of share a little bit about the vision and what we're all about here at New Hope. And then you can ask any questions that you might have, and it'll be a good time together. Amen. Also, if you've never been water baptized, if you have a relationship with the Lord, how many of you know that we're supposed to get baptized after we come into relationship? Amen? Baptism doesn't save you, but it sure helps, right? No, I'm just kidding. We want to encourage you to take that step. What it is, it's your opportunity to let the world know that you're walking in relationship with Jesus. So if you've never been water baptized and you'd like more information about that, we do that the last weekend of every month. And I'm going to be down here at the end of service, so you can come talk to me, and I'll answer any questions you have about that and give you some more information. Also coming up, the last thing I'm going to mention is our Macaroni and Cheese Festival that is hosted here on our church grounds. That's the first Saturday of November. We are looking for some of you to come help us. Last year was amazing. You ladies that were there at our church booth were amazing. I applaud you even a year later. But we want to see if we can get some more people out for this year's festival. There's about 3,000 people that come to the festival onto our church grounds. Isn't that awesome? We had families that came after the festival to come visit the church because they saw their church. They came in to use the restroom, and the worship team was practicing, and they heard the worship. They came in and sat down, and they just enjoyed it and came back. This year, we're going to have, I think it's over 2,000 Jesus films, right? Jesus film DVDs to pass out as part of
what God's doing here at New Hope, and we're going to put the story of Jesus' life and death and resurrection into people's hands. Amen? That's going to be a great, just a great impact. So we want to get some people. So if you can help us out with the Mac and Cheese Festival, just go ahead and just fill out one of the Connect cards and put your name down there and just put Mac and Cheese or Festival, and we'll know what you're talking about, and we'll get in touch with you this week. Again, make sure you read the rest of this because there's a lot of important stuff. Pastor?
Hallelujah. Well, it's Christmas season here at New Hope Church. See, for me, the Global Impact Conference is Christmas. It's the time when we as a church focus on what God is doing around the world and what he's doing through us in the world. And we had a tremendous conference last weekend. I want to applaud Pastor Barry for his leadership and as our missions and outreach director. He did an amazing job of putting the profile together, the graphics, the decorations that we had, coordinating with all the missionaries, and just worked tirelessly along with a team of people that helped him. And if you were a part of that team, I want to extend our thanks as a church for helping to make this year's conference one of the best, if not the best one we've ever had. Amen. Our guest speaker, Carlos Sarmiento, did an amazing job. All of the messages are on our church Facebook page. Or, Brandon, are they on the YouTube channel also? Good. So you can go to YouTube and just put in New Hope Church and look for Global Impact Conference, and you'll see hear the messages. I want to turn your attention particularly to the Saturday morning brunch message. That was the highlight message for me personally. It touched all of us deeply, and I encourage you to listen to that message. Part of why we do the Global Impact Conference is to help our church know what we're doing in the world, to bring missionaries in so that you can hear good news. Because if you listen to Fox or CNN or miserable NBC or MSNBC, isn't that what the M stands for? Miserable NBC. No, I'm sorry. Listen, if I just stepped on your left toe, I apologize. No. Listen, don't get me started. You're not going to hear good news, really the good news of what God's doing around the world. And so the missionaries come in and they share testimonies, and you hear one prevailing theme: God is winning all around the world. God's winning all around the world. I know you'll hear, oh, the Muslims is the fastest growing religion in the world. You know what? I read the end of the book. It's not Muhammad that's sitting on the throne. So realize God's winning. And so part of it is to get the word out. Secondly, it's also for our church to rally together to support the 18 missionaries that we support that are profiled in this brochure. And I'd like to be sure that every individual has one of these so that it could be a prayer guide for you, so that you could be praying for our missionaries. And every day in your daily quiet time, which I know you never miss and are faithful to it, pull this out of your Bible and spend a few minutes praying for our missionaries. Maybe take two or three or four every day, pray for different ones, and just cover them in prayer, because prayer is the lifeline to them. We also support these missionaries financially. We put seed in the hand of the sower. Last year, we gave, I think the number is 22% of our church income into missions. We tithe and more. We tithe and more. Amen. 22%. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. And because, first of all, we believe in the principle of tithing. We believe that it's clearly taught throughout scriptures. So individually, I tithe. Corporately, we tithe. Because we don't want to be a church of thieves, right? Malachi said, if you're not tithing, you're robbing God. We don't want to be robbers. We want to be blessers. We give. And what you find out is when you tie into God's economy, then you have God's blessing and provision. Open heaven over you and your family. And so I want to encourage you, tithe. And so the church tithes, the first tenth of everything that comes in this church that's not designated to a particular fund goes into the mission fund. And that's part of how we support our missionaries. And the other way is to invite you personally to have some skin in the game. In other words, to be investing. Jesus said, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He said that to all of us. Well, how can I go, Pastor? You know, maybe you're 80 years old and don't have the get up and go like you used to. And you think, oh, I can't go. Well, let me just say this. Yvonne Robinson came to me when she was in her 50s and said, I feel called into missions. And so she went on a short-term mission trip, got baptized in the Holy Spirit, came back, said, now what? I said, go to the training center. She said, I haven't been to school in how many years? I said, go to the training center. She went through the training center, did a three-month outreach in the Dominican Republic. She came back, said, now what? I said, have you prayed and asked God where he wants you to go? And she had this line. The Father said. She had a direct communion with the Father. And so she would always say, well, I've prayed, and the Father told me to go to Mongolia. I said, Yvonne, do you know where Mongolia is? She said, it's up north. Do you know that lady went to Mongolia, opened up a school for handicapped. There's never a school for handicapped children there. She went into the local hospital and the handicap that dealt with handicapped kids, and they would just be left in their room all day. So she started activity centers on every floor in the hospital and put Christian literature, Christian books in all of them. And then God called her to go into the Gobi Desert and plant a church. So she bought two camels and a cart and a tent and went 300 miles on a camel and a cart into the Gobi Desert and went to a village and planted a church. She just retired about a year ago, 80-some years old. So be careful when you say I'm too old. But let me tell you quickly. Here's how everyone can participate. Pray. Pray for our missionaries. Two, give to our missionaries. We're asking everyone to prayerfully consider, if you're part of this church family, to be involved personally, financially. Maybe you live on a very limited income. Give a dollar a month. If you can't afford a dollar a month, come and see Jim Kelly. He'll give you a dollar. Wes might give you a dollar. I'll give you a dollar. Most of us could probably do the $30 a month, a dollar a day. It might be a little bit of a stretch for you. Some of you could give $300 a month. As God has blessed you. But everyone, simply do this. Look, this is not a high-pressure sales thing. All I'm asking you to do is pray with an open heart and ask Jesus what he wants you to do, and then follow Jesus. We have raised 42 $30 a month pledges with a goal of 75. And I'm really excited about that. And I'm believing that God will help us before the end of the month to hit that target goal of 75. If you have been giving already from last year, I want you to renew your pledge this year. When you sign that little blue card, it's not an eternal contract. It's a one-year commitment. As God provides, we call it a faith pledge, so as God provides, but you pray, you ask the Lord what he wants you to do. There are pledge cards in front of you. If you don't have them, the ushers will give one to you as they come down the aisle. We're going to receive our offering. And then after Wayne shares the word of the Lord, I'm going to talk to you about the Tanzania Church Project. We're going to receive two offerings today. The first offering is going to be for the church and the support of the ministry here. It's the trunk of the tree. It's the trunk of the tree. From the trunk of the tree are all the branches of ministry. Children's, youth, small groups, missions. Those are all branches. The trunk of the tree is the tithe. It's how we support all of the rest. So this first one is for the church ministry. And let me say to you, I believe what I preach. I believe it. And Jesus said, if you sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. He also said that he would take what you give, press it down, shake it together, cause it to run over, and with the measure you use, it'll be given back to you, but more. And we took a step of faith last week, and God spoke to my heart to say, sow the weekend offering to the missionaries who came to support the mission conference. And we mailed out checks this week for $540 to every ministry represented last week. Amen. One of our biggest offerings, one of our biggest general offerings, and I knew that was going to happen. I prophesied it was going to happen, didn't I? You that were here? And I am believing before the end of the month that God will not only give us all we need to pay our bills this month, but we're going to have extra. There's going to be an abundance because you can't outgive God. You can't. You can't. What you sow, you reap. Amen? Prepare your hearts to give unto the Lord. Father, thank you for the privilege of giving today. Thank you for your amazing great grace. Thank you, Lord God, for what you're going to do in and through us right now. In Christ's name, amen. Now, we've eaten into some of Wayne's preaching time. Wayne is one of the missionaries that we started supporting last year. He's with Plant International. They're doing an amazing work. He'll tell you a little bit about it, and then he's going to share a word of the Lord. Let's welcome him as he comes to share.
Okay. I'll try to be... get this all in a few minutes. Listen, while they're getting that video ready, I just want to say a huge thank you to all of you for giving to our ministry. Pastor Nick, Pastor Barry, thank you so much for believing in us, to invest in us in planting and building churches in Africa. And I just want to say for the worship, you two, how refreshing was that? I travel all over, everywhere, and boy, when I came, the Lord just kept telling me, every time you two walk into a place, it's going to be like a breath of fresh air, and it's just going to just like, and I believe there will be people that will actually smell a freshness as you guys begin to worship. What a joy. Man, I tell you, usually there's so much on my mind when I'm trying to preach or whatever. Man, I just got lost in Jesus. That was fantastic. Watch this video, give you a little idea of what we're doing in a visual. Thank you. few moments, Lord, that you would just speak through me. I pray the prayer that Paul prayed, Lord, that I would not come with fancy speech or word of intellect, Lord, but come with a demonstration of the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, I pray that you change lives. I pray you touch hearts in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Galatians, woo! Man, I love what I do. I am so glad God picked me to go way out in the bush of Africa and do what he's called us to do. We are planting and building a church every 15 days out in the bush of Africa. All of our churches are planted underneath a tree. We actually in many places have elephant watchers while we preach to make sure the elephants don't trample us. This ain't Busch Gardens. And so, man, we are so excited to have the privilege to be able. Are you excited to be where God has called you? Yes, because I can't do what you do, and you can't do, you can probably do what I do, but you know what I'm saying. I could not pastor a church. I just get too antsy. I'm ready to go off to the next thing, and Pastor Nick and Barry, they're just true shepherds, and man, I just love what I do. I just love what I do. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 17, it says this. Paul is speaking, and he's sharing with the Galatians church. Usually at the last couple of verses, he's saying, send my greetings to so-and-so. He's kind of ending that letter. But he just kind of sticks something in there. I feel like just, man, the Holy Spirit just said, put this in, make a declaration, Paul. And he said this, from now on. One translation says, from this moment forward, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my body the mark of Jesus Christ. Woo! Man, you need to know that every single one of you are marked by God. It was almost as if Paul just drew a line in the sand and said, from here on out, no devil in hell is going to give me trouble. You can put in there whatever you want. No person is going to give you trouble anymore. No devil in hell, no addiction, your past, the regrets, your history, whatever it is, you're not going to let it give you trouble anymore. Because if it gives you trouble, listen, the Bible says, and Barry said this, in this life we will have trouble. But there's a difference between having trouble and being troubled. God said he would give you a peace and a rest that would pass all your understanding, all the things that you're going through. And I don't know why Paul said this. Maybe as he was writing, he looked down and he saw the bite mark of that poisonous snake when he was shipwrecked and he was around the fire, and it literally came out of the fire and bit him. And everybody sat around waiting for him to die because they knew it was a poisonous snake. Have you ever been there? When people are just waiting for you to mess up. They're waiting for something to happen to you. Because maybe they just don't like their life. But I'm telling you, you are marked by God. Maybe he reached in his back and he felt the scars of the times he was beaten with a whip. And he said, wait a minute. These scars are because I am marked by God. God chose me to do what I'm doing, and I'm not letting anything or anyone give me any more trouble. When we understand the significance of the mark of Jesus, the first thing is we can bloom where we are planted. Acts 17:26 says this, for one man he made all nations that should inhabit the whole earth. Now listen to this. And he marked out their appointed time in history and the boundaries of their land. Not only are you marked by God, your path is marked by God. God has a path for you. And all he's asking for us is to listen to the Holy Spirit and walk out that path. I can't walk out your path. My wife, we said we would do anything for Africa. You know what that means for my wife? That means working at a daycare. I mean, an inner city daycare. Now she watches our grandkids, but worked at an inner city daycare so that we can meet the needs financially for own life when we started this ministry. I told the group last night, 2016, things were horrible. We thought we were going to have to give up. We just couldn't plant any churches. I only went to Africa one time. It was absolutely horrible. It was in the elections, and things were tough. And I actually went and picked up dead bodies for a living. Literally, 2 o'clock in the morning, they'd call me. There was a dead body at hospice or someplace, and I would go and put that dead body on a stretcher. I would tag that toe, and I would take it to the funeral place. I did that. I tent made so that I could continue to walk the path that God has called us to. You got to get some unction on the inside of you that says, I'm going to bloom where I plant. The problem is this you prayed and you thought it was a prayer request that you would have this incredible job. Oh God, it's going to be the best pastor. It's going to be the best job ever. Oh, if I could just have this. This is what I studied for. This is it. This is it. This is it. If you could just pray. Then you get the job. 2 weeks later, your praise report becomes a prayer request. Oh, I had no idea. Oh, this boss is horrible. People are saying things about me. Oh, this. What happened to God put you in the path? You just didn't like the path. And sometimes the path is going to be bad. It's going to be hard. It's going to be tough. But we have to understand that God has put us there. And it's blue. I am so glad I didn't quit in 2016. Since 2016, 2017, 18, we've built 28 churches. We are seeing multiplication happen. What's the problem? It's simply this. Sometimes you get like John the Baptist. See, we define God through our circumstances. If he doesn't heal, then he's the God that doesn't heal. If he heals, oh, he's the God that heals. If everything is perfect, oh, he's the God that's perfect. When everything's horrible, so God, you don't love me. And you guys are just doing this because you're defining God by your circumstances. This is what John the Baptist did. Literally, Jesus came, and he saw him coming, and John's baptizing people. He's going, wait a minute. You want me to baptize you, Jesus? Yes, I want you to baptize. What an honor to baptize Jesus. God, I'm going to baptize God. And he baptizes God. He comes up and the Bible says that God speaks to his son and said, this is my son whom I am well pleased. John the Baptist got to be a part of that. And then a dove ascended from heaven upon him and the Holy Spirit. John the Baptist experienced all of that. Fast forward 3 years later, he's in jail and he goes to his disciples and says, go ask Jesus, is he the one? What happened? I'll tell you what happened. Jail happened. He was in jail. And he saw Jesus through jail, not through the Word of God, not through a declaration of what God wanted to do in and through his life. We got this pastor, man, we were just believing God where he wanted us to plant churches. And the first time we went to Kenya, we were underneath this tree and where the churches are planted. And Pastor Daniel, who is one of my dearest, dearest friends in Africa, and we were there. They sang and worshiped. We had chai tea and goat. It was delicious. And then he opens up his Bible, old Bible, and he pulls out this old sheet of paper. Now, we had designed. There one church had been built, and we designed that church. Shape, size, dimensions, everything. We knew exactly those size and dimensions. He pulls out this piece of paper of a vision God gave him 20 years earlier. And he had been hanging on to that. It gave it to him when he was in Bible college. A young Maasai warrior went off to Bible. God gave him a vision, and he wrote it down, right down to the stage, everything. He pulled that piece of paper out. Then he pulled out another one. It's old and yellow. He had pulled it out every single day and prayed for his church building. And when he started his church, he'd been underneath a tree for 17 years. Rain, sand, 17 years. He had been praying for that. He pulled out another one that he wrote the same dimensions, and he handed it to me. He didn't even know we were church planters. He just knew we were Mzungas, white people. And I pulled it out, and I looked at it, and tears started streaming down our faces because it was the exact same dimensions and shapes as the churches we wanted. But we knew at that moment. But can you imagine a man that walked the path, was blooming where he was planted, and just kept waiting 17 years? I asked him, I said, did you ever doubt? And he goes, there was times I didn't know if God was going to do it, but I kept pulling the paper out, and I kept praying, and I kept believing, and he was defining God by the Word of God and the vision that he gave him. The second thing is you need to throw off every other mark. Hebrews 12:1 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Listen to this. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. You've got this path, but all you've brought with you things you shouldn't bring with you. You've put on this 20-pound weight of regret. You've grabbed this addiction and you've put it on this shoulder. You hear me? You've taken things that you've heard from the past and you're bringing them into the present, into the future. Like, why can't you be more like your brother? You will never amount to anything. Oh, you're going to start another business? Didn't the other one fail? Oh, you're going to start a church? Well, the last one didn't work so well. And you're carrying all of that, and you're letting that speak to you instead of casting that mark off of you and hanging on to the mark of God and what He says about you. And every time the enemy starts whispering in your ear, you just make a declaration that says, from this moment forward, I'm not letting any other mark get bigger and hang on me other than the mark of God. Man, for me, sometimes it's fear. Man, I get into situations, you know, out there. We've had terrorism, and I won't go all of it, but we've had them take over the mall. I missed it by a few days, and they came in, killed over 60 people with guns, and they just shot them dead. Children were hiding in boxes, and they were coming saying, police, 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 and the kids were jumping out thinking they were saved, and they went, and they just killed them. 4-year-old pregnant women dead. A college not too far away, they killed over 200 people. I saw pictures that the world did not see. And they were literally dead bodies laying on top of each other, 18, 19, 20-year-old. And I live way out in the bush. I've had sickness come on me, and I got no place to go. If you have a heart attack where I am, you just might as well just look up to heaven because you're about to meet Him. You get bit by a snake, sit on a rock, just lift up your hand because Jesus is about to grab it. There just ain't nowhere else to go. And I'm telling you, that'll mess on you. About day 24, you're just going, probably just indigesting, but I don't know. And I was coming into customs one time, and I made a mistake. I printed out the wrong visa, last time's visa. Don't ask me how I did it. I just do things like that. And I handed it to her, I handed my passport to her, and she looks at that, and she's shaking her head, she looks at it, she goes, this is the wrong, you've used this before. I go, no, I haven't. So I'm kind of like, not arguing with her, but I'm just like, no, that's, and I looked at it, and I went, I did. She goes, you're stealing from Kenya. I go, no, it's $50. I'm like, you're stealing from Kenya. I'm just telling her everything we're doing. She gets up, she stomps off, she does this to me, you know. So I follow her up, and I go into this office, and the lady's there, and this is what she says to the lady. She said, this man is stealing from Kenya, and he's abusing me. I know. I'm like, abuse? I'm like, no, I'll pay the $50. I'll do whatever. It's just a mistake. I'm sorry. No. She takes on her offense. She gets all mad. She starts grabbing paperwork. She's just filling everything out. And I'm like, whoa, what are you guys doing? She goes, you're going back to America. I go, no, I don't want to go back to America. I want to go here. I paid to go here. I got people waiting out there for me. You can't. And I started telling her everything we're doing. We're building church. You're a Christian and you would abuse someone? I'm like, stop with the abuse word. Can we pick another word? Just mean or something. Just, can we pull the abuse thing out? I think we've had enough of that. And she's going, and I go, well, I'm just going to turn around and come back. She goes, oh, no, you don't understand. You're never coming to Kenya again. I am banning you from Kenya. And that mark of fear wanted to come over me. And I just said, no, God. And for 2 hours, I just said, please, nothing. They're just filling stuff out. I called Denise, my wife. She's a prayer warrior. I said, pray they're not letting me in. They said, they're never letting me in. And she prayed. She started calling people, and everybody began to pray. And I sat down beside that desk, and she was standing behind the desk. And I just said, God. And I just calmed. I said, Lord, what do I do? And He told me, He said, I want you to kneel in front of her desk, and I want you to beg her to let you in. I said, all right. And I prayed a prayer, and I got down on my knees right in front of that woman. Now, what you have to understand is women are called donkeys in Kenya. No man would ever kneel in front of a woman. And I knelt in front of her. I put my hands on the desk. I looked at her and I said, I am begging you to let me in. And she goes, no. She comes around and she goes, get up. She's looking around. She goes, get up. And I got up. She goes, hold it. And she goes out. And she grabs paperwork and she hands it to me. She says, just fill it out and pay your $50.
just like that.
See, when you don't let that mark get up on the inside, if I had, I would have feared, and I never would have done that. And who knows, I might have missed all that God has done. It's amazing. I walk in there, I'll see her. Actually, next time I saw her, I went and I gave her $50. I said, you and your husband go out to dinner. Every time she smiles. Only God can do that. But let me tell you something. If you take on another mark, it will take you where you don't want to go. It's so vital and so important. The third thing is this. I'm trying to get through this. God has got this. This is what the Word of God says about you. Declaration, line in the sand. Listen to this. Don't touch my anointed. Now, I know this is talking about kings, but you are a priest and a king. You are sons and daughters of the Most High God. And you are anointed. Do them no harm. They are mine, and they bear my mark. If you touch them, you are touching me. Woo! Man, you got God behind you. You've got everything that you need. In Mark chapter 6, the Bible says this about the disciples. They considered not the miracle. They didn't even consider it. The word consider there means this, to thoughtfully think through the situation. It didn't even cross their mind that God, Jesus, who was right there with them, could get them out of their situation. And sometimes we look at our situation without the God factor, without understanding that God says, I have got this. I've got this. Job 37:14 says, listen to this, Job, stop and consider God's wonders. Psalm 77 says this, I will consider all your works and meditate on all your mighty deeds. Hebrews says, consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Man, I remember all the miracles God has done. I pulled them up the same way David did. I remember when you delivered me from the paw of the bear and the paw of the lion, and I know now you will deliver me in this situation. Man, we were in Africa, and we had no place, literally no place to lay our head. We were over here, and I just needed a miracle. I needed a acreage. I needed buildings. I just needed all. Did I have any of it? And I didn't have a penny for it. When I tell you not a penny. Hudson Taylor, greatest missionary that this world has ever known in China, sat in the middle of China with no money, pulled it out, 23 cents out of his pocket, and he held it up to God in the midst of sickness and disease and cannibalism. And he held his 23 cents up to God, and he says, I've got 23 cents and all the promises of God. And I said, God, I just need a little piece of property. I didn't need just a little piece of property. I needed a big piece of property with lots of buildings because I have a big vision. But you know how we got to break it down so God can handle your prayer. Well, God, if you'll just get me to the hospital in time, then we can work on the heart attack later, because I know you got a lot on your mind. I don't want to overwhelm you. Listen to me. You ain't going to overwhelm God. Matter of fact, quit underwhelming God. Step out and believe him for miracles. Pastor, we're believing for $13 million. God just gave me $13 million so we can draw the interest off of it and just run this money till Jesus comes back. And I won't say what we got, but just pray for us. There are billionaires that want to plant into this ministry. People who own football teams. I didn't ask for them. I would have. But I knew their number. Don't give me your number. Pray. So we're out there, and these government officials came to us and said, we had already built 3 or 4 churches. They loved what we were doing. The government loves us. Matter of fact, we've never paid for land. Government comes in and just gives us the land. Man, they gave us electricity. We were out electricity. We were the first ones to get electricity. They literally, because the governor got saved at a funeral that I did. He did. He videotaped it with his flip phone. This is the governor of all the safari area, second most important place in Kenya. flip phone watching it, rededicated his life to Jesus, took the flip phone back to all the offices, started going to all the offices and showing people just getting saved one after another. He says, tell this guy through other people, tell this guy whatever he wants. I said, I want electricity. They were bringing poles, planting poles down the safari road. When they got to our road to Montreal, they stopped and started coming down our road. Now we have electricity. That's favor. God's got this. These government officials, they take us to this place, an abandoned mission field that was there in the 1950s. The Germans, and they just had more money than sense. And they worked for a little while till somebody got sick, and they just abandoned and left. There's just one pastor there. Now that happens to be my partner in ministry. They said, I want to show you something. They show me 18 acres, 10 buildings, a clinic, all this stuff. And they said, we want to give it to you. And they gave us those 10 buildings and 18 acres. And then we started building everything up, and I thought, okay, it's kind of in their name. I'm going to make it all nice. They're going to take it back. And then every 30 or 40 years, they lift the deeds on all the property. It just happened to be that time. Just happened to be. And they lifted all the deeds. And what they do is they take a mass site that's been somewhere, it's got 2 acres, and they'll move them and say, we'll give you 4 acres 2 miles down the road. They lifted the deeds. When they lifted the deeds, they went to me and my partner in ministry and said, what would you like to put the name in? And we literally formed an organization and put the name in there, and it was officially ours. God's got this. God's got this. Every year we have to raise the money for the same amount of churches and then some. It's not in the monthly support. And it's just like another $350,000. I got, how are we going to do this, Lord? Where are we going to do it? But somehow, some way, every year we do more churches than the year before. The last thing is this. Knowing all that, you need to leave a mark. Thessalonians 7:13 says, I, Paul, write this greeting in my own hand, which is a distinguishing mark in all my letters. Listen to me. And I end with this. Paul had a distinguishing way of writing. When people saw it, they knew it. In the same way, these worship couple, you're going to come in, your distinguishing mark is going to be refreshing. You're just going to refresh people that didn't even want to be refreshed. There's this distinguishing mark on Pastor Nick. Honestly, one of the sweetest, kindest, yet strongest people that I have met. And I equate it to like a horse who can pull just about anything. But you look at them and there's such beauty and elegance. And when I see you, I see that. He had a Barnabas had a distinguishing mark. Nobody wanted to go hang out with Paul. The guy that kills people? No, I'm good. What did Barnabas say? He was just an encourager. He goes, I'll go. Let me go. Pick me. And the distinguishing thing about Barnabas was he would come. When Paul said Mark's not suitable for ministry, Barnabas said, I'll take him in. And he loved on him, and he nurtured him, and he brought him back. And then Paul said, oh, Barnabas, bring Mark. He's useful to me again. It was his distinguishing mark. I want to ask you, what is your distinguishing mark? For me, it's Kenya. For me, it's planting churches. That's my distinguishing mark. It's something that's worth begging for. People told me, so, well, you know, they hear that story. Well, you know, Christians aren't supposed to be begging bread. Remember that scripture? I said, listen, when God gives you something, you need to pray. God will give you something that's worth begging for. You don't think I don't beg for my children in prayer? We were in Kenya. We built 3 churches. But they just saw me as the rich Mzungu. You know what that is? Mzungu is a white guy. Okay, my wife's touching. Well, we're done. And I just said, well, I'm white, but that other part ain't true. You know, when you ain't got no money, you go, I'm rich in Jesus. What that means is you're poor, but you love Jesus. But I needed them to have, I needed a distinguishing mark that showed that I was a guy that God had sent. But they didn't see me. Oh, the rich Mzungu's coming. The rich safari guy, they call me. And when I got there, long story short, the animals are dying because it had not rained in 1 year. They were dying. Cows were dead. And I came in. There was 9 pastures. That's the only that would show up. And I said, this is my itinerary. This is what I'm doing. Tell me what's going on. I said, well, it hasn't rained in a year, and everything is dying. I said, come on. We grabbed hands, and we began to pray. And I started praying, and I said a statement. I said, God, I'm asking you to pray that it would rain tomorrow in Jesus' name. And they all started applauding. They're like, yeah. And then I realized what I had said. And I was like, God, if you never answer another prayer, would you please just let it rain? I'm digging a hole here, God. I'm trying to get out of it. And I just, you know, but I really felt the Lord told me, you know, to say that. So I did. I woke up the next morning. I went out and looked outside. Not a cloud in the sky. I'm like, Jesus, this, Jesus. I didn't know what else to say. Jesus. And about 6 at night, it was 9 in the morning, it was 36 hours, all of a sudden there was this huge cloud. By the way, the cloud was over, I didn't even know about the 18 acres in Majimoto, that's where the rain started. And it came to us, by nighttime, it started raining and did not stop raining for 36 hours straight. I mean, there were torrential downpours. We had other people with us, white people with us, Mzungas. And they couldn't get to their destination because of the rain. One of them came to me and said, hey, next time, could you have God just kind of rain it lightly over a period of time? And I go, well, okay. I'll try it. Listen, I prayed for rain and it hadn't rained since. But when that happened, they all came in all soaking wet because they walk. And they were jumping up and down. And they were calling me man of God. And I'm somewhere in between man of God and Rich Mzungu, okay? But a mark was made. And when I went to the churches, and we've never had this before, people I had to preach 2 and 3 times because people, within a short amount of time, had heard the miracle. All of a sudden, I was the guy God had sent. And that's what God wants to do to you. But you got to draw a line in the sand. Stand to your feet. Father, heads bowed and eyes closed. Right now, you got a mark on you. You want off. It's keeping you from doing it. I don't care what it is. It doesn't matter. I'm not the guy that's going to patty cake you. I'm not the guy that's going to try to cheerlead you to do draw a line in the sand. You either want this or you don't. If you got a mark on you, you want God to take off. He's going to supernaturally take it off. If that's you, lift up your hand right now. I want to pray for you. Yeah. Wow. Almost half of you. Father, right now, lift both hands, Jesus. You lift up one, lift both hands. You're surrendering right now. Father, right now in Jesus' name, Father, I ask you to take off these marks. Take them off in Jesus' name, Lord. Take them off in Jesus' name. Father, right now we declare your word from this moment on. Let no one, no thing, no devil in hell, no addiction, no past, no regrets, no history, nothing mark us but you, God. That your mark, God, would shine through, Lord, and all these other marks would literally dissolve and fall off. And we thank you for it now in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Come on, give God a shout of praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just for a minute. Aren't you glad you came to church? I don't know how people think they could do without. Just what an encouraging, uplifting, just spirit-filled day in the house of the Lord. Started in prayer meeting. Actually, it was birthed in prayer meeting, was. So when I was having lunch with Wayne some months ago, and we were talking about actually the men's retreat, and he began to share with me that God has been telling him to now start doing some planting in Tanzania. And so he told me that God had put on his heart to build 2 churches in Tanzania this year. And he told me his church, he can build a church there for $8,000. And so to me, that was like a bargain basement sales, like going to Dollar Tree. Because last year, we committed to build one church in Malawi for $10,000. And then God did exceedingly abundantly above all we could ask or think. And we raised $30,000 and we built three churches. And so when he told me two churches for $16,000, I said, God, you can do that. And I turned to Wayne. I said, Wayne, we're gonna build those two churches. And, you know, I felt the Lord speak to me to do that. And, you know, whenever you make a commitment like that, whenever I do, you know, I'm all full of faith when I make the commitment. But then I drive away and I think, well, that's $16,000. Okay, Lord, you got to do this. And But I just had peace. I just knew God was going to do it. Well, as you know, I've been kind of out of pocket for a little bit. Actually, almost with the exception of one weekend, I've been out of the pulpit for 8 weeks now. Yeah, I preached one weekend. Where's Mike Johnson? He probably already stepped out. He told me, he called me before that weekend. I was in the hospital for a week, almost died. Was out of the hospital a week. Was back in the hospital for a week. Was out of the hospital for another week. Had the kidney stone removed and the stent taken out of my, taken out. Let me tell you something. You can't have any shame in the hospital. You just can't. This little girl that looked like a middle school student who was a nurse in the urologist office said, "Doctor wants me to remove your stent." I said, "You got to be kidding me." She said, "No, sit down and spread them." Steve, it was horrible. It was horrible. It was horrible. It hurt both emotionally and physically. It hurt. It really did. But I digress. But that weekend following all that, I preached. Preached a really great message. Chasing Chariots, you remember? Saturday, I'm sitting in my office there. And Mike Johnson calls me up and he says, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, I'm at the office." "Why are you at the office?" "Because I work here." He said, I'm going to preach this weekend. He said, "No, you're not. You need to go home. You need to go home. Why? What are you doing here? You need to recover. You're going to," and he was just railing on me. He said, you're type A personality, and you're going to, but he said, "And I know you're not going to listen to me." And I said, "Well, amen, you know." But I had to try. Doctor said I could try, so I was going to try. So I didn't stand during the worship. I did very little. I parked my car right outside this door so that I could make an exit. I printed out the notes to my message and gave them to Pastor Karen so that if I couldn't do it, I could tag her and she could come up and pick up where I left off. I'm preaching Saturday night, and in the middle of my preaching, this thought comes into my head. This was a mistake. You should have listened to Mike. But I got through it and didn't spend a lot of altar time with people, and I just exited out and I went home. And then the next morning, I'm thinking to myself, "You should let Pastor Karen preach. You should let Pastor Karen preach. This is not smart." But I had to try. So I came, and I preached, and it was better Sunday morning. I was stronger. I felt good. But as soon as I was done, I was wiped out, and I got it. So then I was, then the next morning, I was shaving. And my heart went into AFib. And I've had that happen a few times before. And, you know, they just shock the heart and get it back into rhythm. Usually this time they just gave me some drugs and it went back into normal sinus rhythm. But the doctor said, "You need a procedure." So that following Friday, I had a procedure done. It was, they call it an outpatient procedure, but I was on the table for 3.5 hours. And then I was out the next morning, and they just cauterized all the nerves that caused the heart to go into AFib and a flutter and some other thing. So I'm all cauterized. And then I've been out, and I'm recovering. You know, I had sepsis, and the doctor said that could take 6 months before you really feel like you have all your strength. And I got a lot of moms. What are you doing here, Pastor Nick? You need to go home. You need to rest. Sit down. Don't, you know, and thank you for your love and your kindness, because I know you're doing it. But I am not going to sit down for the rest. I'm not going to wait 6 months before I preach. I'm preaching next weekend. If you got to stand me up in a stretcher, I'm preaching next weekend. And I feel fine. I do. I feel good right now. But, you know, I'll go home and I'll be glad to be home. And I don't even know why I told you all that. There was a point to all of that I can't even remember now. Now you know my whole, that now everybody knows what's going on there. But I came to the mission conference. I've been out of the pulpit for, with the exception of that one weekend, 8 weeks. And we're coming up on mission conference, and I'm getting stronger every day. I feel it. My stamina is a little bit slower. In recovering, but I'm feeling stronger. And I came to the mission conference, and God just blew me away last weekend. The spirit in the conference, what God spoke to us during the conference. And then, you know, usually when I'm here, 2 weeks, usually before mission conference, I preach mission messages, and I challenge us to give, and I present the goals and all that. Well, I wasn't here to use my exhortation gift. And last year we came into the conference and we had half the pledges we needed, and we had some money toward the church in Malawi. And this year we had 2 pledges of the 75 we're believing God for, and I think a couple $100 toward the Tanzania church. So we raised a little bit, and we raised 40 pledges last week, and that was great. And we raised, between Saturday night and Sunday morning, I don't know, maybe a couple $1,000, something like that, toward the Tanzanian churches. And then Sunday night, we had the prayer meeting. And before prayer meeting, someone in the church, a family in the church, came up to me and said, "Pastor, I want to talk to you." And they took me aside, and they said, "My husband felt strongly that we were to sow into this, and it's anonymous. We don't want anybody to know that we've given." And they handed me a check for $10,000 for the Tanzania Church Project. So now I come into the prayer meeting, and we're worshiping, and the Holy Spirit speaks to me and says this: "I want you to believe me for 5 churches." Well, gee whiz, Lord. I mean, we just got... We're almost finishing the 2 churches here, and now you're putting 3 more on. And it just said, "Just believe me for them." And then I prayed the Rev C prayer. You remember, if you were here at the conference, how when God told him to build 9 churches last year, and he said, "I can't take that on, Lord." And the Lord said, "Don't. Just trust me." And so he heard somebody teach about releasing God's will into a situation, releasing God to do what God wants to do. So he prayed that. And so I prayed that right there in prayer meeting. I said, "Lord, I release you to build those 5 churches and more if you'd like. I just release you to do it." So we are now $2,300 short of finishing the 2nd church. And I've asked the Lord to speak to people, and that we could raise that funding today and finish the 2nd church and then see what the Lord would do. I believe that God speaks to people just like he spoke to me. I believe that God can speak to you. And all I ask you to do, this is not a pressure thing. I'm not trying to pressure you to do anything that's not in your heart to do, but only to encourage you to ask God, listen, hear the voice of the Lord, and then obey him. So I want to take a moment right now because we're going to receive an offering. And I want to just see what the Lord might say to us together. Would you join me in prayer? Would you bow your hearts before the Lord? Father, we thank you. Lord, you have given us a great privilege to be able to be a part of what you're doing in the world today, and particularly in Tanzania right now. God, to plant churches that will plant churches. It's going to be a multiplication, God, an extension of your kingdom among people who have little or no opportunity to hear the gospel. Heaven's going to hear the voice of the Messiah around the throne, worshiping the Lamb of God who is worthy because of our obedience today. And so, Lord, I ask you, would you speak to me? Lord, what do you want me to do? Speak to my heart right now, Jesus. Father, give me the courage to obey whatever you've spoken to my heart. Glorify your name through my giving. While your heads are bowed, I want to just see if what the Lord is speaking to people. Don't look around. This is between you and Jesus and me right now. Has the Lord spoken to anybody to sow a $1,000 gift? Yes, there's one. Are there any others? Has the Lord spoken to anyone to give $500? There's one, two, three. So there's 2,500. Are there any others? Has the Lord spoken to anyone to give $100? There's one, two, three, four, five. There's $3,000. Has the Lord spoken to anyone else to give something? Just lift a hand, whether it's $1, $5, $10, $20, $30. Okay. What I'd like you to do, if you're going to and you have the ability to make a check payable today, then designate it to Tanzania or T Churches, and that's going to go into this church building fund. If you're making a pledge, if you could pay the pledge by the end of the month or at least before Thanksgiving, that'll give a few weeks if you need to move money around or whatever, take one of the blue pledge cards. And if you don't have one, the ushers will have them with them when they come down to receive the offering. And then we're going to receive this offering, and everything in this is going to go to the church planting fund to build churches in Tanzania. And we're going to believe God, and I want you to just join me in faith to believe God that what he spoke to my heart, five churches, that he's going to do that before the end of the year, that we'll have all the funds raised in hand so that we can give Wayne. We're going to give Wayne, as soon as we get the $16,000, we're going to put that in his hand so he can go because he's leaving soon to go to Tanzania, and he'll have the funding for the two churches. October 31st, he's leaving. So we hope to get the $16,000 in hand before. And then by the end of the year, we hope to do what we did last year to present Wayne with the rest to build three or more churches after this. Father, thank you. Lord, as we prepare our hearts to give, glorify your name through our giving right now. Father, glorify your name through our giving. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, men, serve the people. If you need a pledge card, would you please raise a hand? Brittany, Jason, can you guys come up and just close us in a song as we're giving? Hallelujah. What a great day. What a great day. What a great day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Whatever's in your heart, sing.
As a deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. For you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Sing that one more time.
That as a tear panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. For you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. For you strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. And you alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
I pray the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ cover you. I pray the power of the Holy Spirit fill you. I pray the presence of the Father fill your heart and mind, and everywhere you go, you carry the fragrance of the Lord Jesus Christ to everyone in your circle of influence, that they'll be drawn near to the Lord because of your very presence. Go in peace. Until we gather again. If you're new to us, we're going to have a newcomers reception across the hall. Just a few minutes to meet and get to know you a little better. God bless you. Thank you for coming.